Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Church Online with Calvary Chapel Somerville. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We invite you to worship our risen Savior with us today. Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great. Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, You conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Through every storm, You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know You will do it again. For Your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God. You do great. You conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awaken the light. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, You have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, You conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, You do great over.
Hosanna.
Shout Hosanna, Jesus be saved. Shout Hosanna, he rose from the grave. Come and lift him up, Hosanna.
Amen.
Now let the lost be found, forgiven. Death could not hold him down. He's risen, so let the saints cry out. We worship you. We worship you. Shout Hosanna, Jesus is saved. Shout Hosanna, he rose from the grave. Come and lift him up, Hosanna.
Power that rolled the stone away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call upon your name, no other name.
The same power that rolled the stone away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call upon your name, no other name. Shout Hosanna, Jesus is saved. Shout Hosanna, he rose from the grave. Come and lift him up, Hosanna. Shout Hosanna, Jesus is saved. Shout Hosanna, he rose from the grave. Come and lift him up, Hosanna. Come and lift him up, Hosanna. Come and lift him up,
Hosanna.
Come and lift him up, Hosanna.
He's risen. He's risen. He's risen. He's risen. Amen, amen, amen. Father God, we praise your holy name this morning, God. It is a day of celebration, God. We thank you, Lord, that we serve a resurrected King. Father, you have overcome and conquered the grave. You have conquered death, and because of that, we live. Father, we are alive in you this morning, God. May every breath we have acknowledge you and give you the praise due your name. We love you. We bless you. In Jesus' name.
Great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Could imagine so great a mercy. What heart could fathom
such boundless grace. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. And came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Sing it again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. The roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. In your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. A Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. The song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began.
Amen. Hallelujah. We give you all praise and glory. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the incredible gift of salvation, eternal life that we have through your Son, Jesus Christ, and his shed blood on that cross. God, we are blessed among people this morning, God. In the midst of all that is happening, God, we know, Lord, you are in control. You are our Savior. You have conquered death. And Lord, those who believe in you shall never die, but live forevermore. And so, Father, we celebrate the victory of the resurrection, the gift of the resurrection, the power of the resurrection. We thank you, God, and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Well, good morning, and what a great and glorious morning it is. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful this morning for your grace and your mercy, and that you have not dealt with us in a way that we deserve to be dealt with. Thank you, Lord, that you have not dealt with us according to our sins, that you have not punished us according to our iniquities, that you have given us an escape from sin. You have provided us with an antidote for death. You have provided us with a way to escape even ourselves and our flesh and everything that this world and this enemy wants to throw at us. And so we celebrate this morning the awesome, awesome event in history, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Would you bless us today, God, as we open up your word? Would you speak to our hearts? Would you move in this place, and would you move in our community, in our nation, in our world? Would you touch those who are hurting? Touch those who are lonely, those who are shut in? Would you touch all of us today in a way, Lord, that when everything's said and done, we can deduce would only be a supernatural kind of touch? We ask for your presence and your anointing upon our time now. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. While you're turning there, I'm going to remind you there are three ways to give, three ways to support our ministry here in these very trying times. As always, you can give online on our website, ccsomerville.org. There's a button on there that just says give, or says something to that effect. There's also the text to give option that Marcus will put on on your Facebook pages there, the phone number that you can use to text to give. And then you can send a check or send whatever the Lord lays on your heart to our physical address here at the church, which you'll also find on the website. So 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we're going to begin in verse 1 and read down through verse 34. Paul says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received." And then here's that word, here's the gospel message, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep, some have died. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, Paul says, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, Paul says, who am not worthy to be called an apostle. Why? Because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, he says, your faith is futile because you are still in your sins. Then also, those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. They've vanished. They've just withered away. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, Paul says, we are of all men the most pitiable. But, verse 20, now Christ is risen from the dead, hallelujah, and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. But each one in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, afterwards, those who are Christ's at his coming, those who remain on the earth at his second coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power, for he, Jesus, must reign till he has put an end, or till he has put his enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, for he has put all things under his feet. But when he says all things are put under him, it is evident that he put all things under him. It is evident that he who put all things under him is accepted. That is Jesus, accepted unto God the Father. Now, when all things are made subject to him, to the Father, then the Son himself will also be subject to him who put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Otherwise, what will they do? What will they do who are baptized for the dead if the dead do not rise at all? Why then are they baptized for the dead? And why do we stand in jeopardy every hour? The apostles, why do we risk our lives every day for the sake of the gospel if the most important part of the gospel is not true, the resurrection? He continues, I affirm by the boasting in you which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. If in the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage is it to me if the dead do not rise? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. But he says, do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake to righteousness and do not sin, for some do not have the knowledge of God. And he closes that verse, I speak this to your shame. Now we are here this morning, or I am here, you're there. We are here, nonetheless, to celebrate this epic event in human history, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're here to celebrate the fulfillment of God's plan of salvation, the fulfillment of the gospel. And as we make our way back through the first half of this chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the first four verses Paul gives us here, what I believe is arguably the clearest description of the gospel that we find in all of Scripture. Now the word gospel, as you may know, just means good news, or more literally, it means great news. And certainly we are living in a time where good news, and especially great news, ought to be a welcomed word in your home this morning. It's a message of great news, not from me, not from any man. It's a message, it's a word of great news that comes directly from God himself. And it's news that God desires for each of us to hear and understand for the purpose of you and I receiving this news, receiving this gospel as our own. And so, what is that great news? He tells us in verses 3 and 4 that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. God's great news to each of us is made up of those three great facts in human history: that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day. And I think we as Christians, we have the tendency to look at Jesus' death on the cross. We look at the cross as being the sole event that has saved us from our sins and that has given us eternal life. And certainly we should put a lot of focus on the cross, but not so much that we take away from the resurrection. You look at the Catholic cross or the crucifix, they call it. What do you see on that cross? You still see Jesus hanging there on that cross. And so they're putting the emphasis on the cross while removing the emphasis, I believe, from the resurrection. And the resurrection in many ways has become sort of an afterthought in the minds and lives of Christians, as if it were some, you know, an inferior part of the gospel. But Paul clearly states here that there is no gospel and there is no good news from God to man. I mean, who are we that God would give us any news, let alone good news or great news? But he has. He's given us great news. But Paul says there is no great news without the resurrection. I don't know if you've seen what's been happening lately on social media and even on television among the networks. What's happening in our government the last couple of weeks is we're seeing people begin to talk about Jesus. And it's one thing for politicians to make some sort of reference to God. I mean, that's no big deal, because to them, referencing God includes all religions, and it includes all ideologies that adhere to the idea that there is a supreme being, and there is a creator that is bigger than you and I. And most people, most Americans at least, believe that much, and therefore are not offended with people talking about God or using the name of God. So if you're a politician or a public figure, you can admit or communicate your faith in a higher power without offending most people. I mean, maybe you'll offend the ACLU or the far left is that way. That's my left right here. But, you know, the AOCs of the world or whatever, they get offended at anything spiritual. But not most people. What is offensive to most people, however, is the name of Jesus. To talk about Jesus and to mention his name, especially in the context of him being Lord and Savior, that's a whole different ballgame in our culture and our society today. And so not a lot of public figures will do it, especially politicians. And we see that people that do, the Tim Tebows of the world or whatever, they're made fun of by the media. And so not a lot of people talk about Jesus or use the name Jesus. Even some Christian recording artists, believe it or not, they sort of dance around and avoid using the name of Jesus because it alienates them from a certain demographic, and a lot of them are just trying to sell records. So the name of Jesus is very polarizing today in our culture. And I say all that to say, if there is a silver lining to this coronavirus pandemic, it's the fact that public figures, public people, are now beginning to talk about Jesus and to use the name Jesus. I don't know if you heard it, but our president, I was extremely encouraged to hear him as he was addressing the nation on Good Friday. He didn't just communicate the politically safe, let's all trust in God speech. He talked about Jesus, and he talked about the fact that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus has come to save the world. Our president communicated the good news, the great news of the gospel to the entire world, mentioning several times the resurrection. In spite of what I'm sure he knew would spark outrage among his critics, the unbelievers, the heathens, President Trump did what I think God is calling every person in this world to do. In the midst of all this chaos, he has brought each person to a crossroads, spiritually speaking, to where each now is being faced with the question, which direction do I go in regards to my relationship with the Lord? And God says, you're either for me or against me. So no matter if your name is John Doe or Jane Doe or Donald Trump or Nancy Pelosi, God is saying, put away the political correctness, put away that banner, and make a choice. Are you for God or are you against God? And the only way to be for God, according to God's standard, the only way to choose God is through His Son, Jesus Christ. Before the Apostle Paul became the Apostle Paul, he was known as Saul. He was a Pharisee. He thought that he was for God. He was zealous for God in his mind. But the problem was he was against Jesus. And he was presented on the road to Damascus with the truth about who Jesus is. So he was presented with a choice. He was presented with the truth about the fact that Jesus had always been the fulfillment of God's plan to redeem a sinful world back unto himself. And what the president was suggesting the other day was the same thing that Paul communicated almost 2,000 years ago to the Corinthians, that in the middle of this world of chaos, in the middle of death and destruction, our only hope is found in a resurrected Jesus. The life that Jesus lived, listen, the miracles, his suffering, his death on the cross, his burial, as important as all of those events in history are, as meaningful as they are for mankind as it relates to salvation, those events would be meaningless, they would be incomplete without the resurrection. Throughout the book of Acts, anytime the disciples would proclaim the gospel, they would always place great emphasis upon the resurrection of Christ. Not only how important it is to them and to us, but also how important it was and is to God. And so it raises the question, what is the significance of the resurrection? Why is it so important? Why is it important for us to believe and understand and comprehend and receive the fact that Jesus rose from the dead? Why wasn't it enough for Jesus to just die on the cross? Why was it necessary for him to be raised from the dead as well? Not just, I don't want to talk about it in the regards of being an important event historically, but why is it so vital for each of us to understand and be able to embrace with our own hearts spiritually the significance of the resurrection? Well, because your eternal destiny is riding on it. And with greater understanding, with greater enlightenment of truth, comes a greater appreciation of exactly what Jesus has done for you and I. Not only on the cross, but defeating death and holding now the keys to Hades and the grave. So I'm going to outline four reasons this morning, taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, as why the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the single most important event the world has ever known. First of all, number one, Paul alludes to the fact in verses 3 and 4 that the resurrection of Jesus fulfilled many Old Testament prophecies. Prophecies that God had given concerning the coming of the promised Messiah. Paul said, not just that Christ died for our sins, but that he died for our sins according to the Scriptures. It had been prophesied. It had been predicted. It had been prophesied that he was going to be buried and that he was going to rise again on the third day. As Paul says, according to the Scriptures, Jesus himself said, destroy this temple, his body, in 3 days he would raise it up. So his resurrection was according to what had already been written, what had already been prophesied, all the way back in the book of Genesis. After the fall of man, the sin of Adam, God promised a Messiah who would come and save the world, who would come and undo all of the damage that man had done through sin. The Old Testament scriptures went on to declare that this Messiah would ultimately suffer at the very hands of those he came to save, that he would be rejected and cut off, crucified by his own people. But the Old Testament prophecies didn't stop there. David proclaimed that though the Messiah would be killed, he wouldn't be in the grave long enough for his body to even begin the decaying process, which happens on about the fourth day. Jesus himself, again, he said, destroy this temple. 3 days I will raise it up. Given the prophecies concerning the resurrection throughout Scripture, had Jesus not risen from the grave, had he just come and, like what most believe, just been a good moral teacher, had he even been crucified, but if he were still in that grave, we could not give him any consideration whatsoever of being that promised Messiah. But he did rise from the grave. And so the empty tomb proves that he was the one that the prophets had been writing about for thousands of years before his coming. Proof that he is the Messiah based on the surest thing that we have in this world, the Word of God. If you are new to the Word of God, if you're a new Christian, it is imperative that you understand the role that prophecy plays in the Bible, and particularly as it relates to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Over 300 prophecies given in the Old Testament alone about the Messiah, so that when he came and fulfilled those prophecies, we would recognize who he was. The law and the prophets, the Old Testament, from Genesis to Malachi, from the beginning to end, all it was God painting a perfect portrait of the Messiah, little by little, just painting with a brush, a perfect portrait of the Messiah, so that when the Messiah came on the scene, we would be able to look at that portrait, and we would be able to recognize that Jesus in the flesh, God in the flesh, this is exactly who had been written about. This is exactly who had been prophesied of. Jesus came and fulfilled the prophetic writings about the Messiah right down to the most minor detail, so that you and I could have what Paul calls a reasonable faith that Jesus is that promised Messiah. We can conclude that just by reasoning from the Scriptures. God made it so that we could search the Scriptures for truth and then be confident in that truth, because Scripture then confirms its own validity through prophecy. 29% of the Bible, almost a third of the Bible, is made up of prophecy, where God tells us in advance the things that are going to happen on this earth. And so when we see these things transpire, we can come to the reasonable conclusion that the Bible stands alone as God's own handwriting, because it's the only book in the world that proves itself to be true. It's the only sure thing that we have in this entire world. The reason the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the single most important event the world has ever known is, number one, it fulfilled prophecy. Number two, the resurrection of Jesus validated his claims of being equal with God, validated his claims of being the Messiah. Jesus, while on earth, he claimed to be equal with God. He claimed to be the Messiah. That's what got him crucified. The Jews saw it as blasphemy to make such a statement. Only God could speak the way he speaks. Jesus forgave people of their sins, but only God can forgive sins, the Pharisees would say, and they were right. So he claimed to be the Messiah. All of his teachings, all of his miracles, his death on the cross, all were validated by God through his resurrection. It was God's stamp of approval, the resurrection was. It was God's stamp of approval that Jesus' death on the cross was sufficient payment for your sins, for my sins, that God accepted this offer that Jesus made to become the sacrifice of the world. Paul said it in verses 17 and 19. He said, and if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. Paul couldn't have stated the importance of the resurrection any more seriously than he does in those three verses. If Jesus is not risen, then what's he saying? He's saying, take your Christianity and throw it out the window. If Jesus is not risen, take your Bibles and throw them in the trash can. They're useless. The cross, the gospel, everything, it's meaningless. Why? Because we would still be in our sins. The third reason that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the most important event in history, we find in verses 20 through 23, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man Adam came death, by man Jesus also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. The resurrection of Jesus has removed the sting of death for you and I. When God raised him from the dead, he opened up the grave for anyone and everyone who would put their faith in Jesus. I like this quote from C.W. Hall. He says, "The resurrection of Jesus changes the face of death for all his people. Death is no longer a prison, but a passage. It's a passage into God's presence." Easter says, you can put truth in a grave, but it won't stay there. There's no other religious system in history, apart from the Bible, that has an answer for even the origin of death. Why do we die? Why does death reign in this world? Go read the book of Genesis, chapters 1 through 3, and you'll find out why. But no other religious system can offer you an explanation as to why we die, let alone provide you with the power to overcome that death. What Paul is saying is that to follow any religious system that doesn't provide you with an antidote for death is just foolishness. Because to every single one of us, death is our enemy. Why would I follow after a God who has no answer for the greatest enemy that I face? Why would I follow after a God who is subject himself to that very same enemy? Paul says in verse 32, I'd be better off eating and drinking and just, you know, getting everything out of this life that I can, following after my flesh. I'd be better off doing that because death is going to have the final say so anyway, if Christ is not risen. So don't put your trust in any religious system that offers no solution for death. Don't be persuaded by other people's words and opinions about what happens after you die. Don't be persuaded by your own feelings about what you might think happens after you die. Jesus didn't just talk about his authority over death. He went and demonstrated it. Many people will talk about their authority. Many religions will talk about having an answer or some sort of authority in the next life. Jesus is the only one who went and proved it. He's the only one who can provide you, therefore, with the solution for death, because he's the only one to defeat death. Oh, death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? There's a story about a boy who was deathly allergic to bees. He and his father were riding in the car one day and realized that a bee had become trapped inside. The boy began to scream and to flail his arms around, and he began to swat at the bee, and swatting at the bee just made it more agitated. Until finally the father was able to take his hand and to trap the bee on the car seat. And a few seconds went by. The father picked up his hand and he released the bee, and then the boy once again started to scream and yell until the dad showed the little boy the palm of his hand. And he said, "Son, that bee, he can't hurt you now. His stinger is gone." And that's what the resurrection of Jesus Christ did for all of those who have put their faith in him. Now, should the Lord tarry, each of us are going to face death. Christians die every day. But what I want you to know this morning is if you die, Christian, death can't hurt you. Why? Because Jesus has removed his stinger. He has taken away the sting of death. The fourth reason that the resurrection is the single most important event for all mankind is because it has a purifying influence on the life of a Christian. We look at verses 32 through 34. If in the manner of men I have fought with the beasts at Ephesus, and these beasts that Paul's referring to are men who wanted to tear him literally limb from limb. Why? Because he had declared the gospel to them of Jesus Christ. He declared that Jesus had risen. And so he says, what advantage is it to me that I've fought with these beasts and I've suffered all that I've suffered if the dead do not rise? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. If the dead do not rise, then why don't you just go ahead and lie and cheat and steal and follow after your lust? Don't be concerned about anyone else other than yourself. Get everything out of life you can, because you're just going to die. And that's going to be it. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. But if the dead do not rise, he says, awake to righteousness and do not sin, for some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. If you believe in the resurrection from the dead, what Paul is saying is, stop acting like you don't. The knowledge of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is calling you to what? It's calling you to holiness. Understand that Jesus rising up out of that grave is what facilitated you and I one day being able to rise up out of our graves as well. That's the great news. And it's the kind of news that when it is sincerely received into a human life, the only way to respond to that awesome gift and reality, the only way to respond to that awesome news is with holy living. And understand, one day we're going to give an account as to what we did with that news, what we did with the gospel, what we did with the blood of Jesus, and what we did with the resurrection, and the fact that we have been given victory over death ourselves. We're going to give an account as to our faithfulness in that regard. How have we responded to what he has done for us? And so, as a born-again believer, I ask you this morning, how are you responding to the call that comes with being saved? How are you doing with your call to holiness? The resurrection of Jesus ought to drive you and inspire you to live a life that is set apart, consecrated unto God, knowing that I am going to stand before this resurrected Jesus one day, and I'm going to give an account for my faithfulness, not for my salvation, but for my faithfulness. Knowing that, it motivates me to live righteously. It gives my life here on earth eternal meaning and purpose. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ, just to sum it up, it fulfills the writings of the prophets. It validates Jesus' claims of being the Messiah. It removes the sting of death for you and I, and it calls every one of us who believe into a life of holiness. If you believe this morning that Jesus Christ is just some figure in history, or that he was nothing more than just a good man, a good moral teacher, if you, like most of the world, adhere to this false ideology that there are many roads that lead to God, then I challenge you this morning to examine the evidence of the resurrection. Examine the one thing that sets Jesus apart from every other religion and every other worldview this world has ever known. Examine the evidence. Harvard Law professor Dr. Simon Greenleaf, he says, according to the laws of legal evidence used in courts of law, there is more evidence for the historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, not just the crucifixion, But there is more evidence for the historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus Christ than for just about any other event in history. God has provided us with more than sufficient evidence. Again, Paul himself said in verse 6 that over 500 people at one time witnessed the risen Lord. And even though it's, you know, some 30 years later when Paul was writing this, he says most of those witnesses were still alive at the time that he had written this epistle, the 1 Corinthians. So you got 400 people or so, let's just say, that you can call to the witness stand that will testify of seeing Jesus alive after his death and burial. The disciples, you think of them, you know, when Jesus was being crucified, what'd they do? They all scattered. Strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. That's what they did. They went in hiding. They were all afraid for their lives, with the exception of one, the Apostle John. But they all thought that Jesus' ministry, they all thought that what he came to do, that it was over, that the enemy had won. Jesus told them he was going to rise on the third day. But it didn't make any sense to them until they actually physically encountered the risen Lord. Then everything changed. These men during Jesus' crucifixion, who out of fear disassociated themselves with the very one who they had been calling Lord for 3 years. Suddenly, these men got a new eternal perspective on life. All 11 of them, Judas notwithstanding, you can add Paul into the mix there, but they were all, once they saw Jesus alive, they went from being cowards to becoming heroes of the gospel. They sacrificed their very lives to take the gospel into the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, here is the most crucial point to that. These 11 men, they either saw Jesus alive after he was crucified, or they didn't. They absolutely knew the truth. One way or another, they knew the truth. But the compelling argument here is no one ever died for something that they knew to be a lie. Someone once said to me, the disciples, you know, they stole the body of Jesus to further their agenda, popular belief, and you know, for the naysayers. But I said, well, what was their agenda? And he said, to spread the gospel. And I was like, well, yeah, but what kind of earthly gain was it for them? What did they get out of it? I mean, they knew that they would have to leave behind in order to spread the gospel. They knew they were going to have to leave behind their wives and children, their homes. They knew they would have to abandon successful businesses to become poor missionaries. They knew that they would be persecuted. They knew it had been prophesied that they would be tortured, beaten, that they would all ultimately die violent deaths, crucifixions, beheadings, boiled alive. And they all did, with the exception of John, who was the only one lived to see, you know, to die of natural causes. But even John was the one that was boiled alive and survived. But you know, that's quite an agenda they were trying to put forth, wasn't it? And there's only one thing that makes that kind of agenda worth it all. It's only worth it if it's true. It was only worth it to them if it's true. No one ever dies for what they know to be a lie. And they knew it to be true because they had encountered the risen Lord. Have you encountered this morning a very much alive and resurrected Jesus Christ? And it's a question that carries with it eternal ramifications. I challenge you this morning, examine the evidence. Examine the evidence. Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful for your indescribable grace. We're so thankful, Lord. The fact that you came to this earth. You didn't just give us your word and said, read it, understand it. You came and you demonstrated your love. You came and demonstrated a perfect life. You came and demonstrated the fact that you are not subject to death, but that death is subject to you. And you did it all for no other reason but your love for your creation. As your word says, for you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should never perish, but have everlasting life. You died for the sins of every person who's ever breathed a breath of air. For every person who's ever been placed in their mother's womb, you died in their place. And you rose again so that they might have victory over death as well. And so may we never take the resurrection lightly. May we recognize this morning that the crucifix, the little emblem with Jesus still on the cross, it's wrong. Because you have overcome that cross. You have overcome the grave that you were laid into. And you've given us the opportunity, just by faith, that those who would just simply call out to you, those who would make you Lord and Savior of their lives, your word tells us you are just and faithful to forgive our sins, to forgive us from all unrighteousness. You are just and faithful to give us eternal life, that we might be with you forever and ever. And so would you bless us on this Easter Sunday, God? Again, the most important event in the history of the world. Would you bless our day, God? Would you be with those, again, who are suffering, those who are sick, those who are afraid, those who have lost loved ones, those who are battling, again, those who are lonely. Pray that they would feel a touch from you this morning. We pray an end to this coronavirus, Lord, but not until it has done and fulfilled exactly what it is supposed to fulfill in this world. We love you and praise you. We offer ourselves to you in this day to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You know what I'd like to do? I'd like to bring the worship team back up. And if you don't mind, we're just going to do another worship song or two. We haven't even rehearsed anything else, but just feeling like we are supposed to do that. So if you want to stay tuned and just worship with us for a couple more songs, either way, we love you. And just remember, we're praying for you, and hopefully we'll all be back together very, very soon. So God bless you. Have a blessed and awesome week. Stay with us. Do you feel the world is broken? You do. You feel the shadows deepen? We do. Do you know that all the dark can stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. Is all creation groaning? It is. There's a new creation coming. It is. Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is.
worthy. Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move upon us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah born forever those who love?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is. He is. He is. He is. He is worthy. He is worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy of this. He is.
My past has been redeemed. Jesus, you have given us freedom. Now no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness, you have given us freedom. Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Given us freedom, you have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom, you have given us freedom, you have given us freedom. Hallelujah. Now I have resurrection power. Living on the inside. Now no longer bound by sin and darkness. Living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. Now I have resurrection power. Living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. Now no longer bound by sin and darkness. Living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I have resurrection power. Living on the inside. Given us freedom. You have given us freedom.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Have a blessed week. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to Changing the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.